We confess you as ruler and Lord and King over all. There's none like you, O Lord. None to compare with you. None who can come close to you. As you yourself said through the prophet Isaiah, is there any other God like me? I know of none. Lord, you know all things. Father, we confess you as the great and mighty God. We confess you as he who has a great plan for his creation, a great plan for your church, a plan so great that you redeemed us with the blood of your own Son, just so we could carry out that plan, be a part of that plan. You're a God so great, none can stand before you. And every enemy falls in your train. Great are you, Lord, and worthy of praise. Hallelujah. And Father, we would just ask this night that you would help us to take captive every thought, and that we could train them and focus them to obedience to Christ. Deliver us from wanderings of mind and coldness of heart, O Lord, that we may hear your word for us this night. For truly, Lord, it is your word for us, for this cathedral of the King, and for us as individual members of this flock. We just pray, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, and that it would accomplish that purpose for which you sent it. Truly, Lord, you promised that your word has this power, and may it be fulfilled in us this night. We thank you, Lord, and we give you praise and glory, you who love us with an everlasting love. And we just confess this night, Lord, we love you. We bless you, Lord, we love you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. Let me ask, how many of us were here this past Sunday, May 29th? Most of us were around, right? Quite a few. I wanted to help us remember something that happened this past Sunday. Should be easy to remember, it's just 3 days ago, right? No big problem. How many of you remember what happened in the service after the Eucharist was finished? After everyone had partaken of communion, all the deacons and priests went back to their places at the altar, everybody went back to their places in the nave. What happened after that? Who remembers? Was it Deacon Meyer? I think you got it. What's that? No, that was after the prayers of the people. Talk about after the communion. Now, you weren't there, Bishop. How come you know? Nobody else knows. All those who were there didn't remember. The bishop who wasn't here, he remembered. That's why he's the bishop, guys. You got powers like that. You get to be made bishop just like that. Yeah, a prophetic word came forth. Remember, Bishop Dick came forward and he began to prophesy. That's one of the gifts of the Spirit. We're going to be learning about these things as we go on, because we're the charismatic Episcopal Church and we need to be very comfortable with the gifts of the Spirit. And the Bible says something particular about the gift of prophecy. It says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 20, despise not prophetic utterances. Now, what does that mean? That means when God brings us a prophetic utterance, when he gives us a word of prophecy, we should pay attention to it. Too often we don't pay much attention. Maybe we listen while the prophecy is going forward, and first we kind of wonder if this is in the Spirit or not. I don't know. course it is. So as it goes on, they go, that's good. I like that. Amen. Okay. Then maybe when the person's done, we go, yay. As if we're saying, good word, God. Nice job. Way to go, God. You know, sometimes we sort of have that attitude. But when Paul says to the church at Thessalonica, despise not prophetic utterances, he means a lot more than just, yay, God, go, Jesus. Good job, you who spoke the word. Oh, nice for you, too. When it says don't despise it, it means go back, listen to it, study it, apply it. Don't just take it for granted. And by all means, believe it. Goodbye. By all means, believe it. Now, how can we believe what we don't remember? Yeah? Good point, Father Gary. Yeah, sure is. So, what I want to do tonight is take a few moments and go over this prophetic utterance that the Lord gave through Bishop Ricardo. First, I'm going to read it, and then I want to just touch on some points here, emphasize some things that were spoken, because, you know, Bishop Ricardo is not a member of the Cathedral of the King. He has his cathedral in Calipo. He doesn't attend here once in, you know, every few months or something he might be here. But yet, it was as if he had been here every Sunday and every Wednesday night all year long, because he was touching on so many things that we had been sharing and reflecting on and applying ourselves to. So let's listen to this, and then, as I said, we'll touch on a couple of points. The Lord says, never forget that I have already spoken my word to you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I spoke that a long time ago. It never loses power. Don't forget that my light is greater than your darkness. Don't ever forget that I am fully capable of delivering that which I have promised to you. There's a scripture that says that which God's promised, he's able to perform. It says of Abraham, he believed that the thing which God promised to him, he was able to perform. Straighten your shoulders and walk with a sense of thanksgiving. Not murmuring, not complaining, not criticizing, thanksgiving. Walk with a sense of praise towards me, for I rejoice in your praises. I've noticed your tears. It says in Psalm 56, I think it is, Lord, keep my tears in your bottle. They are in your book. That's what it says there. He says, I've taken them. They have served as reminders to me. One day, you will see that which I am preparing for you. For those who are saying that it might take a long time, have you forgotten that which I've spoken, that the nation would become a nation in one day? You are living in a time of acceleration. Do not measure achievements and events by how you've experienced them in the past, for I am releasing my angel, my hosts, and they are delivering provisions and resources to you. For those of you who would respond to my call, don't wonder that I've been waking you up early in the morning. Anybody been waking up early in the morning anytime lately? Sometimes you wake up early and you want to go back to sleep. You know, Lord, I got to get up later and I got to work hard and I need to, but you just can't go back to sleep. You thought it was because of something you ate before you went to bed. Maybe that glass of tea that you had or the cup of coffee. According to the word from Bishop Ricardo, that was the Lord waking you up. I am asking you to spend time with me. There is something that I would like to do through you. For those of you who would respond, you will find yourself walking in a deeper sense of anointing. You will walk in the spiritual gifts. Begin to desire them. Be not afraid of that. I've given them to you to bless you and the people around you. I'm the Lord your God, and I will never leave you nor forsake you. Now, how many of you have committed this to memory already right now? Maybe not yet. Well, I'm 99% sure it's loaded on the website by now, because it came into my inbox, and usually when it comes to my inbox, it's already loaded on the website. So I would encourage you to download it from there. If you can't, we can probably make it available here and, you know, make copies available, because this is word of the Lord. That's why it's called a prophetic utterance of the Lord, because it's the word of the Lord. And it's God's direction for us. And as Paul told the Thessalonians, don't take it lightly. Don't neglect it. Don't despise it. Now, I just want to, like I said, highlight a couple of things here. In the first paragraph, a few sentences down, he says, walk with a sense of praise towards me, for I rejoice in your praises. Never let praise become routine. Never let worship just be something else that we do in the service. Something we do on Wednesday night, something we do on Sunday morning. We lift up a song, we lift up this or that. Sometimes in our Bible study, maybe we'll sing. Maybe when I'm, you know, doing whatever I'm doing on the way, commuting somewhere or doing something, I just have a little song in my mind or something. Never take that lightly. Listen to what the Lord said, and this is out of Scripture too. He says, I rejoice in your praises. Do you know that you have the power to make God rejoice? The Almighty Creator of the universe, the one who's everybody's under his feet, every name that is named, everything that's created, everything under his feet, you can make him rejoice. Think about that for a minute. You ask the average guy on the street, you think you can make God happy? You know? He'd think you're crazy. Of course not. He's God. I'm just a person. And yet, you are a person whom God gave the ability to make God rejoice. Don't take that for granted. Don't take it for granted on Sunday. Don't take it for granted on Wednesday. Don't take it for granted every minute of your life. Especially you who've been given the gift and the calling to minister to the Lord through the King David ministry. Never, ever go, oh no, another rehearsal. Don't ever say that. Instead say, Father Dino, can we extend rehearsal today, please? Can we rehearse 2 days a week, please? Three? Can we find time to do that? That should be in our hearts. Whether it's logistically possible or not, I'm not saying. But that should be our desire. If an opportunity for ministry should come up, be it a wedding or a resurrection mass or an extra service or an evangelical trip or whatever, we should be the first to say, yes, it's a chance to make God happy. Count me in. Because that's the calling and anointing God's given us. But it's not just for the King David ministers. All of us have been gifted with the ability to please the Lord. Don't take that for granted. Don't take it lightly. It's a privilege, and it's a joy to do that. Because when we worship the Lord, His presence is there, and in His presence is fullness of joy. So that's just the first little thing I want to bring out, first out of seven that I've got listed here. Don't take for granted the privilege of pleasing the Lord in your worship. Second point I want to bring out, for those who are saying that it might take a long time, talking about God fulfilling His promise to the cathedral. Not just the promise of the last week or two, but the promise of the last 30 plus years, 35 plus years. He said, for those who are saying it might take a long time, have you forgotten that I spoke to the nation that it would become a nation in one day? This is a passage from Isaiah chapter 66. And I'll just read it to us. In Isaiah chapter 66, verses 7 through 9, I believe. 7 through 10. It says, before she travailed, talking about Jerusalem, symbolic of God's people, before she travailed, she brought forth. Before her pain came, she gave birth to a boy. Now that's pretty unusual. How many of you are mothers, ever had children before? How many of you ever worked with Sister Chapa? You ever seen a woman give birth before she started having pain? That's pretty weird. Very unusual. But the Lord is saying, this is how quickly I'm going to do my work. Then He says, who has heard such a thing? Who has seen such a thing? Can a land be born in one day? That's where the prophecy is talking about. Can a nation be brought forth all at once? As soon as Zion travailed, She also brought forth her sons. But then God bringing forth to us a little bit of logic. Shall I bring to the point of birth and not give delivery, says the Lord? Or shall I who gives delivery shut the womb, says your God? Or shall I give you the land and not give you the ability to build on it? Shall I give you the Holy Spirit and not give you the ability to minister under the anointing to people under the bondage of darkness? He said, if I brought you this far, I'm going to bring you the rest of the way. And once I've gotten you here, you'll be surprised. In one day, symbolically, it'll happen. Be joyful with Jerusalem and rejoice for her, all you who love her. Be exceedingly glad with her, all you who mourn over her. Because the Lord says, it's not going to be, a long drawn out thing, maybe as much as you think. Because I'm the God who can make it go down in one day. The next sentence also is kind of related to this. It says, you are living in a time of acceleration. When he said that phrase, it kind of perked up my ears. Time of acceleration. I feel like this is one of the key phrases in the prophecy. It's kind of explaining the previous sentence, but it also has something of its own when he talks about a time of acceleration. He's not just talking about doing his work quickly. He's talking about doing the work with passion, with intensity. You know, there's several ways you can get from one place to another. Sometimes when my family and I are going to the market or going wherever, a lot of times we'll walk, because it's faster to walk sometimes than to wait for the Jeep and get the Jeep and take the Jeep through the traffic and everything else. There's what I call, first of all, the stroll. To be honest, I hate to stroll. Stroll is when you're like, I hate to do that. Now, if I'm a tourist and I'm going around to someplace new, stroll is fine. But if I want to get somewhere, I want to walk, I want to go live. And people tell me I always walk kind of fast because I want to get there. I want to do what I need to do and get back and do the next thing. You've got your strolling. That's one way to get somewhere. You've got your walking, which is good for normal everyday situations. 99 times out of 100, maybe. But the Lord said, you're not living in walking days. Right now, you're in a time of acceleration. And in times of acceleration, what do? You don't stroll. You don't walk. You, come on, think with me.
Run.
Thank you. We run. And it's a time, in this time of acceleration, it's a time to run. Run is something you do with intensity. Run is something you do with purpose. It's interesting because just the Wednesday before that, I had gotten a scripture from the Lord. And it was in Psalm 119. And it said there in verse 32, I will run the way of your commandments. Now that's unusual because many, many times in the Bible it says to walk in God's ways, to walk in a manner worthy, to walk in the paths of the Lord. It says that many times. You can look in your concordance and see that phrase is used often. Rarely, only two or three times, does it say this, to run in God's ways. Because why? It's a time of acceleration. It's a time of intensity. Remember back at the first of the year, at the end of last year, the prophetic word from the House of Bishops, intensity of prayer. Now the Lord is saying, don't just be intense in your prayer. Be intense in your faith. Be intense in your life with the Lord. It's time to run. It's a time of acceleration. It also says in Psalm 119, verse 60, which was in the reading this morning, the Psalm reading in the daily office. It says, I will hasten to keep your commandments. Hasten means to go fast. Again, we're talking about a time of acceleration, a time of intensity and speed. It reminds me of when Elijah, after the Mount Carmel experience, after he had had that time where he called down fire from heaven, then he defeated all the 450 prophets of Baal and slayed them. Then there had been a drought, and Elijah said, okay, the battle's not over yet. We've got to see rain come again. So he started praying for rain. We talked about this a few weeks ago. We were talking about spiritual warfare. How Elijah got down on his knees and put his head between his knees and was praying so fervently. And eventually, after he looked seven times and prayed seven times, a small cloud started to appear. Elijah told the king, "You better get ready, king. It's going to rain." And the king took off in his chariot from Mount Carmel and began to go to his palace in Jezreel. And it said that Elijah, filled with the Spirit, started to run. And he outran the king all the way to Jezreel. Now, I'm not talking about from here to there. Maybe I can outrun a chariot from here to the wall. Maybe I can outrun a chariot from not much further than that. But the distance from Carmel to Jezreel is about 25 miles. Can you imagine outrunning a horse and a chariot for 25 miles? Because in Elijah's life, it was a time of acceleration. One man against 450 prophets of Baal, and he won. That's acceleration. That's God fulfilling his promise to his prophets. That's the time we're talking about. The time where God is fulfilling his purpose. And in one day, he defeated all the work of the enemy there in the kingdom of Israel. So it's a time of acceleration, as he said here. Now then, I'm going to go down to the third paragraph, pick out the fourth point here. For those of you who would respond to my call, don't wonder that I've been waking you up early in the morning. Again, I touched on this when I read it first. Intense prayer, even early in the morning. We've been talking all year about the intensity of our prayer lives, about seeking God, truly seeking His face. As He said, I want to spend time with you. I want you to spend time with me. Won't develop this too much because we've been doing it for 6 months almost already. But notice that even here in the prophecy, the Lord said, I've been waking you up. That's for the purpose of me spending time with you so I can tell you what I want you to do. How many of you know God has something for you to do? A job for you, a mission for you, a purpose for you. How many of you know that? Good. But knowing that is good. Knowing what it is, well, that's even better. And he said, that's why I'm waking you up in the morning, so you'll know, so you'll hear my word, so you can accept the calling and say, yes, Lord, I'll take this mission. Yes, Lord, I'll take this calling, and I'll run with it, like Elijah did. Fifth thing I want to share with you, that's from the beginning of the fourth paragraph. For those who would respond, for those who would say, yes, Lord, I'll wake up and I'll start listening to you, not to just say, Lord, stop waking me up early in the morning. I'm sleeping. If that's the way you work, don't expect a lot of anointing from God. He'll still love you. He'll still use you. But if you really want God's best for you, when He wakes you up, shake yourself and listen. He said, for those of you who would respond, you will find yourself walking in a deeper sense of anointing. You will walk in the spiritual gifts. Begin to desire them. I know there are several of us who have been seeking for the spiritual gift of praying in the Spirit, especially since we've been talking about it the last few weeks. Don't despair if you haven't received it yet. The Lord is reminding you here, He will give this to you. He will give you this deeper sense of anointing. You will walk in the spiritual gift. And the more you desire it, the more sure you're receiving of it. Don't be discouraged. Don't think, oh, I guess I'm just not good enough. I guess it's just not God's plan for me. I guess I must be doing something wrong. Maybe it's not even real. Don't fall into that. God knows. God knows the time that you need to receive it. God knows the right time. There was in the daily office this morning was the passage from Ecclesiastes where it says, to everything there's a season, a time for this, a time for that. God knew 2 weeks ago wasn't the time for you. God knew 1 week ago wasn't the time for you. Maybe God knows tonight is the time for you. But the Lord promises here, He spoke through Bishop Ricardo and said, seek those spiritual gifts. Seek that deeper walk. And if you haven't yet received that, what we call prayer language, praying in the Spirit, keep seeking and you will find. He said, seek and you'll find. Knock and the door will be open. Ask and it shall be given. The sixth thing that we'll talk about here, the next to last sentence in the prophecy, talking about the spiritual gifts, he said, I have given them to bless you and the people around you. This goes back to what the Lord spoke to us more than a year ago, one Sunday in June, when he said, we've drifted from blessed to be a blessing, which is what we should be. Now we're blessed. Thank you, Lord. The reason we're blessed is to be a blessing. We had gotten off, we'd lost that. The Lord is bringing us back there. In the last year, the Lord is taking us through some really hard trials and some hard places, but His goal has been to get us back to that place where we hunger and thirst for the righteousness of being a blessing to other people, for being a light to those in darkness, for being a healer to those who are sick, to being a word of truth to those who are in the darkness of deception. He's bringing us to the place where we're hungry for that. And he says, that's why I've gifted you with these gifts, so that you can bless others. And I sense that a number of us are there. A number of us really have that hunger in our heart. Lord, let me serve you. Lord, let me touch one of your people. Let me be a source of encouragement. Let me be a source of hope. Let me be a source of life to those around me. And as you pray that prayer, the Lord says, I'm giving you gifts so you can fulfill that. This is what the Lord is reminding us of this night. Now, one more point I want to bring out, not so much from this prophecy, but about a summary of it overall. How many of you, again, we'll have another memory exam, remember the theme from this past Sunday? Uh-oh. Who has it written in your note? Okay, good. Yeah, I'll let you take English this year. You're so good for that. Okay, what is the theme for Sunday, last Sunday? The goal of knowing His authority. A little harder now. The goal from last week. Uh-oh. The goal from Sunday before last, which was the 22nd of May. Yeah, hey, look at Mika, she's got it again. Which is? You know, I'm not mad you're cheating by reading your notes. I'm glad you took notes. And I'm real happy. The goal of knowing the Trinity. Now, what do we find in common with these things? And I'll give you a heads up. Every theme all the way to November is going to have this common phrase in it, which is the goal. Now, where did we come up with the goal? Why is that there? Bishop, you should remember this. Why is that phrase the goal in all of the themes for 6 months this year? Remember back in, I think it was November, when we had our all workers meeting, and Bishop gave us a word from the Lord, just like Bishop Ricardo did last Sunday. Bishop Ariel said, I've heard from God, this is the theme for this year. Pressing on toward, the goal. Parts of this year, our themes have been about pressing on, but for this last half, it's about the second part of the theme, the goal. Now, if that is a prophetic word from the Lord, again, we should not despise that prophecy. We should take it to heart. Yes, we're pressing on towards that goal. Not just the goal of the piece of land over here, but the goal of being on fire, dedicated, fervent, intense ministers of the Holy Spirit for the glory of God. That's the goal. If we have that, building the church won't be a problem. Building seven churches won't be a problem. When we have that, and that's our goal of having that intensity. That's why the phrase Paul put there, pressing on for that goal. You can't be intense without the spirit and attitude of pressing on. And that's what this prophecy is all about. It's calling us back to that intensity. It's calling us back to that fervent spirit. It's calling us back to that focus, to that strong desire, that zeal to serve God and to bless His people by His Holy Spirit. That's what the prophecy is about. And as I say, I encourage you when you get it, when you're wherever you're with whatever device you have that helps you do this, download that and keep it with you. Because that is, you know, that's where we need to be. That's what we need to focus for. That is our goal. When we talk about pressing on towards the goal, that is the goal. Have it with you. Have it in you. And fulfilling that is part of why we're here tonight. Because tonight, on Wednesday nights, as we've been doing, we pray intensely. We've learned a lot about it. We've been practicing it. And God's been working. God's been answering prayers. But now our time for teaching is over. Now it's time for prayer. And I want us to get into the same groups we've had for since several months now. Again, if you've not been in a group yet, make one. Join one. But get together and let's pray again. Several issues of prayer. Number one, of course, is our mission team, which is already in Leyte. Let's pray that God anoint them with His Holy Spirit, that His work be done, and the purpose for which He sent His word would be performed. We have no idea what God is going to do in that time. We've had other missions, certain things have happened. If we're expecting just that, we're missing the mark. Expect something greater. Expect something beyond. And so let's pray for something greater, something beyond, something more than what's been done in the past. Like the prophecy said, don't be thinking this is going to go on like it has in the past. That was then, this is now. Do not measure achievements and events by how you've experienced them in the past. That's what he says here. For I'm releasing my angels, my hosts, they're delivering provisions and resources to you. What provisions? What resources? The gift of the Holy Spirit. Well, let's pray that those gifts come upon our team members and others who were there, that the Lord can do His work in that place. And not just now, these next few days, this week, but let it be something with continuity and something with expansion and something with growth, explosive growth. Let it be the beginning of an explosive growth in the Diocese of the Visayas. Let it be so that Bishop Dick just is at a loss for what to do because there's so much kingdom work that's right there in front of him. And he even has a lack of people and ministers to bring it forth. Because that's the will of God. And then pray it happens in Luzon. Because that is the will of God. That's one prayer. Another prayer. In the back end of the verse, Psalm 119, verse 32, I was telling you about. Lord, you make me run in the way of your commandments. It says, because you enlarge my heart. Now that doesn't mean literally your heart gets bigger. That physically happens to runners. Because runners, they exercise their heart, which is a muscle. When you exercise a muscle, it gets larger. And so literally those, particularly like the marathon runners, their hearts a bit larger than most people because of the exercise. But the Lord is not talking about physically a bigger heart so that you can physically run more. He's talking about a spiritually enlarged heart. When he's talking about heart, he's talking about courage. He's talking about passion. He's talking about bravery. He's talking about commitment to the Lord. When he says, Lord, the Lord will enlarge my heart, that's what he means. And tonight, maybe if you're feeling, my heart's really not as large as it could be. I wish my desire were more. I wish I were more zealous for the things of God. One prayer we can pray is, Lord, enlarge my heart this night. Or you can pray that, as we've been learning, for someone else. Maybe someone in your group has that prayer. Pray for them. Maybe someone you know. You know that the Lord wants them to enlarge their heart. Ask the Lord that they would also have an enlarged heart. Those are two things which we can pray for. I'm sure there's many more that will come up as you begin to pray in the group. But now's the time to pray. With these two things as a guide and others that will come up, let's get together in our groups and let's, with intensity, with passion, with focus, pray in the spirit, pray with the understanding, but pray with all focus and intensity, the will of God. Okay, so let's